The ratings for the Olympics this year have not been great. However, Disney couldn't possibly have known that in advance when they purchased, I'm sure, very expensive ad time for two of their biggest holiday movies. Moana, the TV spot we're going to go through in just a moment, and then, of course, Star Wars Rogue One, a movie whose new trailer, which already, I believe, I think this is going to be the same one that premiered at Star Wars Celebration Europe a few weeks ago, will finally debut to the public on Thursday. And maybe as the Olympics progress, this might be the circumstances under which we get that Guardians of the Galaxy first look. But anyway, what's interesting about Moana and Rogue One is that these are both beach vacation movies. So we'll see how they do during the winter movie-going season. Although I have to say with both of them, every time I watch the trailers, no matter what qualms I might have, I'm always like, man, I want to be on that beach. I don't care if it's next to Maui or a stormtrooper. It looks fantastic. You can feel the warmth radiating off the screen. But anyway, let's take a look at this Moana TV spot, which I think is almost entirely, save for like one shot, new footage. So that's pretty good to cram into about 50 seconds. So I think it's interesting. You can see here we have the that beautiful beginning to the Disney intro to their films. You know, they played around with it for The Jungle Book, and they made it Disneyland specifically. And it was just so enchanting that I wish they would play with this part of the logo as they often do the castle, you know, changing up what the castle is. But I think it's interesting they would take their some of their precious 50 seconds to do this, and I think they maybe want to make sure that they have the brand recognition for Disney there strong, being like, pay attention, something Disney is coming your way. And the Disney name is mighty powerful these days. But there's still a couple crossfades. Shorten that thing. Now, this is interesting. As they go out over this expansive ocean, like a grandmother-type voice, and maybe it's Moana's actual grandmother, a character in the movie who she's very close with, saying, in the beginning, there was only ocean. And of course, the ocean is very much a character in this movie, something that Moana says has chosen her, or at least likes to play with her, as we saw in the international trailer, and you're gonna see a little bit here. Although I don't think it's as well realized here, and something I didn't even pick up on the first time I saw it, as many of you noticed in my live trailer reaction. But anyway, in the beginning, it was mostly just ocean, which is a pretty nice place to start. And I think that storytelling and myths and legends are a big part of this movie, as is often the case with any culture, but particularly, you know, I think any kind of tribal culture, right? I mean, I think maybe we lose some of our, you know, our myths and legends as time goes on, or we have commercialized ones. But this is very much supposed to be the story of Moana and her people. All right, so Disney presents, and I love this. Ah, she looks great. I like Moana quite a bit. I think that's the necklace that we've seen her grandmother wearing, and we've seen some illustrations of her grandmother giving it to her at D23. But look at that beach. That beach is just so beautifully realized. And to the animator's credit, even though Moana doesn't look like a real person, she doesn't look like she doesn't fit on that beach either. So they've managed to meld like the reality of the location and the backgrounds with the somewhat surreal aspects or fantasy aspects of the characters who populate it. So that's hard to do, but I'm very, very impressed. I think it's because Moana and Maui and all these characters look a little bit like dolls. That's something that Frozen, of course, had as well. But Frozen, because it was so often like a snowy landscape, you know, it took place a lot of times at night, we didn't really have as strong a feel, I think, for the backgrounds in that movie. So Moana, though, very much the setting is a real place. And I guess that's because it's personified. You know, again, that ocean back there is her pal. All right, so she's trying to recruit Maui, and he's not having any of it. Now, this to me, you can see when he jumps up here, the mountain kind of exploding behind him, and it seems almost like ash. So, you know, you're going to see a lava monster momentarily in this TV spot. So I don't know if he's awakening a volcano, trying to get away from it, but it looks very cool. A lot of flipping around in this movie. Okay, now look at this. He throws her off the boat, right? You see this rooster here, this chicken? Hey, hey, voiced by Alan Tudyk. It does nothing. Look at that. It didn't even flinch. And I want you to remember that lack of support later on in this very TV spot. So thanks a lot, rooster. So he also, I don't know how I felt about him throwing her off of the raft. I was like, that seems a little bit too hardcore, you know, like more than a little love tap, right? So he throws her off the off. I liked his hair though. That was pretty cool too. The way his hair moves like that. That's pretty neat. It looked very real to me. I like that. Now this banana distracted me actually because I don't think this is a very well animated banana. Everything else looks great. My biggest complaint is about this banana because that banana is too long and thin, and it looks too much like the teeth on his necklace, right? So it was just when I first saw it, I was like, "What's going on there?" It's very distracting. But anyway, I didn't like that. But here, she's trying to recruit him some more. She's saying he's a shapeshifter, a demigod. He's of, like, the wind and the earth, but he this doesn't, you know, some people felt that it said he controlled them. That's not the case, at least so far. But here, she's saying, I love this. Now, this is so cool. She's saying, you're going to be famous if you help me out. Now, the details on his tattoos are so fantastic. Look at this. If you look at it again, you can see the swirl next to him is vibrating like a speaker. That's just so great. Oh, I love it. That's really well done. And then here, he enjoys it. Now, I didn't like this, actually, where Moana's like, you know, it's her voice. She's talking and making him feel good about it. But I didn't like it so much because here's the one point where it took me out of, like, the time period, where it felt very, very modern, right? And I think that's something that all animated movies suffer from a little bit these days. You know, Disney used to be kind of immune to it, but I think when they're new era and they have to be a little bit more competitive, they sometimes make that mistake too. Like, I don't think that you ever watched, you know, like Cinderella or even Beauty and the Beast, you know, a more current film and felt like, oh, she's like, you know, like a current character, a modern day character. Like Belle was never like, totally, or like, no way. That would have been ridiculous. So I don't know. That's my one little problem with that. But she looks fantastic. Now these, don't they look, you know, when they look like, sometimes they do look like dolls. They remind me of those dolls that smell really good, you know, the Carol dolls. I think so. That's really funny. So anyway, these are some pirates they have to deal with. They're very odd creatures. They like to wear coconut husks, and then you can see they've built these giant floating ships that almost look like islands. And then you can see there's Moana's poor little raft in the middle. But they almost remind me a little bit of Snowgies from Frozen Fever. You know, just like this, you know, they just scream marketing to me. Not so much what's the best for the movie from a storytelling perspective, but what can we sell a lot of, right? Who doesn't want a coconut husk with little arms and legs coming out of it? You can collect all the different ones. But let's see how they act in the movie. But here, oh, there they are. They move pretty cute. And I do like the Snowgies, all right? So they look adorable. They look pretty cute. I don't know what they're made out of. They're obviously pink, as you can see. I hope this isn't a retread of the dreaded trolls from Frozen. But they had their fans, so let's see. That's amazing. That's the best thing. This sold the whole TV spot in advance. As I said in my reaction, I think maybe they should have saved it for the TV spot because this was the money shot. You know, we've talked a lot. Some of you like the porn version of a money shot. That's how you think of it. Giving away that you are porn frequenters. But for everyone else, a money shot is like the big selling point. Like the best example is the White House exploding in the Independence Day trailer, right? So anyway, this is something where you start to think, okay, this is more than just a Disney movie, right? Or a Disney princess movie. This is going to go for epic scale. You've got the lava monster. You've got the lightning in the background, the beautifully realized clouds. It's just really cool. It's the kind of thing that says you should pay to see this in a theater and maybe even in 3D, right? Which is exactly what Disney wants you to hear. So I think it's spectacular, and I hope to see more of this in the coming weeks as they promote the film. But it's very ambitious for Disney, and there's also an artistic quality to it, which I really appreciate. Like, they could have made a cute lava monster, but the fact that it's an abstract, somewhat actually genuinely scary lava monster makes me just so happy and excited. All right. Now, Maui was saying, have you ever defeated a lava monster? And she's like, no, have you? And obviously the answer, she looks really great there. And the answer, he's obviously is like, no. Now, here you can see his tattoo keeps score, and he sends him to the back. I think that's great. I love the use of tattoos here. You can see they detail Maui's exploits. This is going to be very important coming up. And something else is revealed. Look at the quality of that hair. That looks so real. That's so neat. But anyway, as I've said before, I love that The Rock himself actually sports intricate tattoos like this. So I think it's a great choice for the character. And, you know, again, you know, the movie's just so well set up for merchandising and integration. You know, could sell cool shirts. You could have tattoo, you know, temporary tattoo stations. Who doesn't love a good temporary tattoo? Some people love a good permanent tattoo. But it's great. It's like the, you know, even Harley Quinn's, Harley's tattoo parlor, right? This could be like the kiddie version, although I believe quite a number of kids like Suicide Squad. All right, so anyway, moving on. Dwayne Johnson gets top billing. Now, that's very important. I think we're going to have a musical number here. But you see on the back there what's spotlighted? That is a giant crab, which, of course, as we've already met, is the villain of the film, voiced by Jemaine Clement, and the character is Tamatoa, a villainous kaiju crab that has taken Maui's magical hook. I don't know what he's carrying around for most of the movie. As I said before, it's the keychain version, who knows? But, you know, that's obviously the Maui storyline, and he's about to fill us in whatever the sequence is going to be. So maybe he gets that, or maybe he just got that tattoo back, who knows? But that's an important part of the story. I like how also that shot looks so classically Disney musical number, right? But here you can see stuff gets real, where it looks like that's the hook that he's supposed to have, his magical fish hook. And I do like the way that it lights up and glows. That's very cool. I would also like to purchase that at the theme park at night, maybe. Whoever's on the Disney marketing team, they must have been sitting on some story meetings, because this stuff is excellent. So he looks like, you know, this is one of those prove yourself moments in the movie, right? Like, you've been a jerk this whole movie, Maui. It's time for you to step up to the plate and prove your worth. And he's like, I'm going to do it. So he takes off. That's awesome. Now you can see there are a lot of different vessels in this movie. This is not the vessel that they've been riding with the swirl on it that is Moana's that we see at the beginning of the film. His hook looks really cool there, the way it just kind of seems like a full glowing hook from when they're speeding up. So I'm wondering where all the different ships are coming from. So anyway, Aulili. Cravajo gets second credit, but you know, she's no Dwayne Johnson. But you can see she's doing the old Pocahontas leap of faith there, and you can see that that's her ship, and she's catching up. I guess maybe he wanted to take it, who knows? But there's Maui, she's gonna join him. Now, see this? She's saving the rooster, even though that rooster did not care that she was thrown off of her own ship, all right? But it looks like they're gonna have some cool action sequences. I wonder how Moana got so good being like action sequences, right? She's like, I'm best friends, you don't know this, with Mila Jovovich. It looks cool. I'm hoping for some really good action sequences. Also a little bit Tarzan-y, come to think of it. And I'll be very impressed if this animation team can direct some good animated action sequences. That's a skill set on its own. So I like the camera movement with the character movement. I think that's really neat. There she is again. They're really playing up the Lin-Manuel Miranda connection. And for some of you, you've said that's the main reason you're going. So I think that maybe they should have let him voice a character. Now, this is important. You see these ships? Pay attention to them. It's going to come up momentarily. But you can see that on most of these sails, they have stories written on them. That's also important. But perhaps Moana's sail is just a swirl because her story has yet to be written. All right. Although Maui apparently can keep rewriting his. Now, you see this? This is a different boat than the one that she's on. It's not hers, and it's not the one that we see Maui on later. This is a different one, and I like this. This seems like maybe like, you know, banging the drums to keep the beat maybe for rowers, right? So she does that, and she awakens these torches all on their own, which is pretty cool, and ties in, of course, with the Olympics, light the torch. But you can see behind her, those ships on the sail remind us very much of the ships that we saw previously, and also the whole idea of ships sailing toward land. In the beginning there was just ocean, and then there was land. Where did the people come from? So there's some kind of story being told here that the ocean maybe wants her to hear, right? Because the ocean picked her, she says. You can see I like that running her hand along the legend, right? Like, what? Tell me the story. And the shape-shifting again. And he falls. This looks like the boat that we see him earlier on in this spot with the hook. There he throws her in again. Now you can see here, she comes right back up with a blob of water. I don't like that. I was like, oh, she's an amazing swimmer. And some of you pointed out, I'd be really upset that he kept throwing me off this boat. Okay. I'd be like, really uncool. But anyway, the way she's put back up on here, you know, as you can see, just like in a blob of water, I don't know how she's breathing in there. I would prefer that the water, like, carry her like it did when she was a baby. Like, create some kind of cool throne or put her in, like, an air bubble within the water. I just felt that was kind of unceremonious and a little bit hard to tell what was going on. So I didn't like that so much. But I like dripping wet Moana. That's adorable. She does not look pleased. And then that rooster's not even around. He's, like, taking five off frame. He's like, I had to try. Oh, there he is. I hope that rooster is as funny as Disney is planning for him to be. And then, as you can see, Thanksgiving. So I'm very excited about this. It's very well realized. I really like it a lot. Who doesn't like the Polynesian setting, right? So now all Disney has to do is, you know, stick the story. So far, so good. Also, you can see 3D. Who's not going to see a movie about lava monsters and lightning and water in 3D, right? I think this could be potentially quite profitable for Disney. But let's not forget that one of the reasons Zootopia did so well was not only world building, but a really strong and actually really interesting and bold message for today. I think that's what powered Zootopia along with the world building, but here it might be the setting and that soundtrack. So do your work your magic, Lin-Manuel. It's time to prove that you're not just a one-shot guy with Hamilton. If he can do this, Lin-Manuel will be golden. But he still has Mary Poppins in the wings, so he's got a couple of chances to prove himself that he's someone who could consistently, or at least most of the time, deliver. But I have to say, the song, We Are Explorers, you know, that's sung over the trailers, that's really starting to grow on me. So I'm like, this is a good song. All right, so write your thoughts down below. Thank you for watching this with me, and you can check out some more Moana coverage right now.